My name is Talat. I work on the Palo Alto Networks and in the streaming infrastructure team. In this talk, I will explain that our journey. This talk is kind of gathered the last 2 or 3 years around it, because not everything is not happening at the same time. Just step by step, we face the issues and other things. Let me go through the agenda first. Today, I will explain to you Cortex Data Lake, which is our product. And Palo Alto Networks is a security company, and Cortex Data Lake is the help the security applications to secure our customers. And then we will go through our streaming infrastructure, how we implement that, what we are doing. And I will share some challenges that we face. And last section is the performance improvement, and what we saw and what we did to improve our performance. Let's start with the Cortex Data Lake. Cortex Data Lake basically collects and transforms the enterprise data from their firewalls or security device or network devices, and we collect all of them on the Cortex Data Lake infrastructure. On top of that, our Cortex applications secure the enterprise data. The data is coming from come from the cloud data centers, corporate networks, or user endpoints like our user computer, or our managed service like data centers, branch, or mobile users. The main goal is that we want to build a data lake for all of them, a unified form of for the applications. Let me give some information about the data lake. We serve several regions, and we process a few million events per second per region. And our upstream applications consume those events, securing and creating the analytics on top of it. As Pablo mentioned, that we start slowly, but today we have approximately 10,000 plus data flow beam streaming job, and it's keep increasing based on our application usage and the new applications. Okay, most probably the previous slide, I assume that you understand that our firewalls or network devices send the data. Today, for streaming infrastructure, Kafka is the de facto tools. And we also used on our backend Kafka. And all of the events land on the Kafka. Let's think about that. As a security application, how you can consume those events. We should build something else. And you know that the answer, this is a streaming applications. But there's a ways, right? When we built Cortex Data Lake, there was a discussion kind of, okay, we land the data on Kafka. How we let the applications process those data? Should we let the applications directly consume from the Kafka, or should we create an infrastructure? I will pause in here and just answer by yourself. What will you do in this case? You will let the applications write their own data flow jobs or beam jobs and consume the data and deal with the general infrastructure issues such as Kafka migration, partition increase, or tenant discovery kind of use cases, or are you going to build the infrastructure for common needs? We took the common infrastructure way. And we call that it is a streaming infrastructure. And we start for the streaming infrastructure, we asked our applications what we want to do and how we want to do that. We should model the those needs a way then that they can describe their needs directly to us, and we can run the jobs for themselves. We call this model is a subscription, like newspaper subscription or any subscription, like PubSub also has a subscription model. Our subscription model has few important items. They communicate with us through the REST endpoint. On the REST payload, they define that application name, which is their application name, SQL query, which is their business logic, and it's powered by the Beam SQL. It could be a simple filter or projection or stream aggregation. Even, I didn't show in this payload, but if they have the custom business logic, like they want to look at some specific their method related with their metadata, they can also include the user-defined function or external tables on the Beam, whatever the Beam support. In addition to that, on the Kafka, our events has a common schema and common format, but they may not be interested in that format and they want to use different format. Our Kafka cluster keeps the data as our binary, which is schema awareness and also the kind of efficient way for us. And they may interest on the JSON. We are asking them to what kind of output format do you want to receive after the result of your SQL query. And the last thing is that what kind of things do you want to write it? This could be anything that you need. Definitely there is a more settings in the subscription payload. I just emphasize the important ones. Otherwise, we are asking them to retry count, and batch size, those kind of things. I hope I clear your understanding in the subscription payload. Now I want to explain to you kind of overall view for our streaming infrastructure. I explained the subscription payload, and imagine that you are an application which you want to consume a data from Kafka. Kafka is here, and Cortex Data Lake producer is right on Kafka, and you want to do your business logic. This is not easy when I explain that, but actually, in the practice, it's very easy. You just send the REST payload, whatever we described before, and our API server, whenever we receive your REST payload, we validate few things. If you pass the security check and validation, we return to you a subscription ID, like taking a ticket. And based on your subscription ID, we don't guarantee you we will deploy your data flow job right after it. You have to check. This process is asynchronous. The item one and item four is actually asynchronous process. You send our subscription, your subscription payload, and we return to a subscription ID, and you keep checking that subscription ID. Behind of the scenes, we have three different components. One is the API server, as I said, you know, serving the applications to give subscriptions and do all of the CRUD operations, create, update, read, delete. And the second application is our deployer. It is kind of brain of our system, because whenever you describe the subscription, we create a deployment request based on the subscription. Your subscription doesn't have Kafka location, for example. You just tell in your SQL query, you just tell the tenant ID or whatever the tenant it is. But in our metadata, we have Kafka clusters informations, and we have schema informations, whatever we need as specific for infrastructure. We gather all of the informations from our metadata and bundle with your settings and create a deployment request. This deployment job deployer responsible to submit a Beam job Today we are using a data flow runner. I can call a submitted data flow job. This is our beam job, real SDK. Based on your payload, we generate a beam job. It's not static code. It's generated on the fly and submit data flow. Okay, when you submit data flow, if you use before, you can know that, right? Whenever you submit a data flow, it's not going to be run immediately. Our job deploy portal keep checking the data flow APIs to, until the job is getting running state. Whenever it gets the running state, we turn to the subscription and say that, okay, your job is done, start running, and you are good to go. To handle the dead cases, we introduce a subscription state on the subscription model, and we say that pending deploy means we got your subscription, and you have to wait until we deploy. If you say deployed for your subscription state, and you know that, okay, your job is running, there is no issue. And when your job is running, basically it's just read from Kafka and send your application's endpoint. I hope so far it's clear. Let's look at about our data flow jobs. In this diagram, I just explained a service, microservice, which is owning the job submission. Real data for streaming job, real work for streaming job is running a data flow jobs. Our data flow job is very simple. Basically, it has, if you think about the, this is a one step, it has four step. When we started this implementation, actually at that time, data flow doesn't, Beam doesn't have the SQL support. That's why the first initial version was that reading from Kafka.io, then creating the batch and writing the scenes. Let's go to the steps. You know, the yellow ones are actually provided from the Beam SDK. Blue ones is written by us. And we use Beam's Kafka.io reading from Kafka. Then our Kafka has the Aura binary. That's why to run on the SQL transform, we need to turn down the Beam row, then the Beam is provided a SQL transform. We generate it generates the Java code based on our SQL. Then with that SQL, we filter or we do whatever business logic in here. Then output of the SQL transform, we turn back the desired output format. It could be the same row, our row, or it could be the JSON, CSV, or any format. And later on, we have the results, but we need to send those results to application's endpoint. For that, we create two simple steps. One is the sync. We don't use the Beam's IOs for the sync section. I will explain that later why we don't use it. But we implement our own syncs and variety of syncs we have it. And we also create a batch creator, which is an external step. We don't want to deal with the batch creation for each thing and re-implement it. That's why for your usability, we create the batch creator. By the way, this is only the one pipeline, but when I say the 10,000 jobs, the jobs has the multiple pipelines. We start with the single pipeline, then we result that, we understand that okay, single pipeline is not enough. And some of the applications needs multiple pipelines. And we start generating the DAGs on the same data flow job multiple times. And based on those things, we also create the DAG optimization based on the application payload. Okay. As I mentioned that we use Beam Data Flow Runner. And we generate DAGs based on the application REST payload and several different outputs we are supporting, Aura, JSON, CSV, key value pairs, and several different things we have it, HTTP, gRPC, SysTalk, storage, SQL, kind of BigQuery. And our system is support the applications, subscriptions, create, update, delete operations. And also for, as a common system, we have self-healing for Kafka changes and cost optimizer for, we call the cold starter. I will explain them, the self-healing and cold starter, how we implement and why we need it. Okay, this is overall our infrastructure. Let's look at the challenges, what we had while implementing this infrastructure. First of all, as I mentioned that our deck was very simple, reading from Kafka and sending to the sync. Then the applications start complaining about that. Okay, I'm not interested in the all of the events in the Kafka, I'm just interested in the subset of that. This was the first request that came to us. And we start thinking about, okay, can we implement projection and filtering, at least on a simple version? And we go for it, BeamSQL. It was a January 2019 aroundish, and there's a BeamSQL. The challenges for us at that time, almost zero tutorial about the BeamSQL. We literally read the unit test and try to understand how we can use the BeamSQL. In addition to that, we use the Avro and we try to, whatever we learn from the unit test, we try to apply on our Avro schemas. Then we realize that Avro Utils doesn't support enums and Avro record namespaces. This was a breaking deal for us. That's why we fixed our utils. Then it wasn't finished because, you know, we were trying to implement only the basic filtering and projection, but even for filtering and projection, BeamSQL didn't work because at that time, at least BeamSQL, BeamCalcRel doesn't support. It used to support complex type, but it doesn't support the raw type. Raw type means for us, if you use Avro before, we define a custom record, and in our general record has the custom records, multiple custom records, like Java classes, you can think in that way. One Java object has another Java object as a field, same cases. We modeled that use case in the row, and one row column can have another row model. And it solves the most of the issues, but after this solution, we found that Calcite has an issue. And the issue is that when you have a row column, that column, if any internal row column is nullable, the column become a nullable. It wasn't desired behavior, at least if you think about the database. You know, if you have a one column, it should not make all of the rows is nullable. And the end of this investigation, this took approximately 1 month, by the way, one engineering month. And we patched the Calcite, we patched the BeamSQL, and we patched the Beam's Avro Utils to give a support for basic filtering and projection. Today, we use our custom version of the Beam, and hopefully we will go to the open source version. Okay. Second challenge is that reliable update case. Dataflow has unique feature, which is dataflow updates. If you are running streaming jobs and if you have the states, dataflow update is prevent you to lose your state or corrupt your state. It is good for the stateful applications, but our initial jobs was not stateful application. It's just simple filtering and projection. All of them is stateless. Then we realized that when we try to update the data flow jobs, some reason for internal state is tied with the Kafka partition count. And if we increase the any topics partition count or do anything else on Kafka side, the update is broken. Then this use case is not working for us. We have to build a reliable update solution. What does mean the reliable update? data flow update is very fast, and it just takes 3 or 4 minutes to update the data flow jobs. That's why we first try the data flow update. If data flow update is successfully, then we say, okay, update is done. But if it is not successful, as you saw that on our job deployer service, we created another workflow which we first drain the job, and after the draining the job, we start the new job, exact same name, but updated payload. And we call that reliable update. This feature is key for us because update is kind of important for our customers, and also update is important for our management. Sometimes we want to roll out a bug fix or anything else on the job side. We don't change any payload, but we have to update the jobs itself. Reliable update help us to do that. Okay, we got the reliable update. This was the awesome milestone for us. Then, okay, what we can do that? All of the Kafka changes, we can handle another service we call self-healing. Any reason, if Kafka change, like Kafka migration, our SRE teams, Kafka teams may migrate a topic from one cluster to other cluster. We have a bunch of clusters. And based on the customer's traffic, we may need to increase the partition count or decrease the partition count. Decrease keys is not supported from Kafka. We have another way to decrease it. I will explain that. And we introduced that service as a self-healing. What the self-healing is doing? We have a Kafka checker, which is continuous to check the Kafka, then store the states and information on a data store. Self-healing is just check this data store. If it sees any differences, find the data flow job, which is affected by that difference, by that change, and update that data flow job using the reliable update. That's why it is important. This part was missing for us. And as I mentioned that we do the Kafka partition increase and decrease based on the traffic and also migration. For those needs, Kafka checker is a very critical part for us. Almost every minute is check all of the Kafka cluster status, topics, partition count, offset numbers, and persist the data store. And Kafka partition increase, look back at a certain time window. And if traffic is increasing for that tenant, we increase the Kafka partition count. And same scenario for decreasing. It's longer window, and definitely decision is taking more slowly, but we do that. For decrease case, as I mentioned, that Kafka doesn't support the decrease. What we are doing that, first, we give the support to migration. Migration is handled by the self-healing. And we create another Kafka topic for same tenant and start consuming both of them on the same data flow job. And eventually, whenever the old topic is drained, we delete the old topic and continue the new topic. Decrease do the same thing. It just create a new topic with lesser partition on Kafka, and our producer start produce on that topic, and self-healing is just act as a migration. These automations like reliable update, self-healing, Kafka partition increase and decrease, it relieves us a lot for 1,000 jobs. Okay, another challenge we saw that on the Beam SQL, Beam doesn't support the schema changes. If we changed our schema. And if we directly turn to the whatever schema it is as a raw schema, the Beam SQL is start complaining and start throwing the errors. This is very painful for the select star cases, because select star applications, they want to get all of the fields, but Beam doesn't have the new fields or changed fields. And the only way that generating the Beam SQL Java code resubmitting the data flow or beam jobs. Luckily, we found a way on the Avro side. Avro supports some kind of schema evolution. For that, we introduce a metadata information on Kafka side for each event has a writer schema version. We know that which schema version we use to write into that event. On data flow side or Beam side, we have data flow job schema version, which is calling the reader schema, and each job has their own reader schema. In our to role step, we read the writer schema and reader schema, then gave to the our parser. Our parser has LLC compiler, which is define the which fields should be on the reader schema side, and on the fly we change that behavior. This is good, and because of this feature, we handle the self-healing. We add some kind of additional feature on the self-healing. We detect that if the change is not affected the job SQL, then we don't restart those data flow jobs. If change is affected to that job SQL, such as select star case, it means they want to get all of them. The self-healing is reliably update the data flow jobs.
Oh.
Okay, last slide is the performance improvement. For performance improvement, one of the customers came to us and said that we want to process near real time. Until that time, we didn't understand how latency we are adding on the processing side. Then we realized that, okay, we have the batch creator. Then at that time, we want to control the sync side payloads. That's why we start using the group into batches. It was our initial implementation. That's why we are not clear about the group into batches. And eventually we learned that group into batches provide some kind of shuffling state, which is costing a latency. Then say hi to local group into batches. The basic idea is that we use the splits. Inside of the split, we create the desired chunks and emit those records. And we don't do the shuffling. When we remove the shuffling, it increased our latency allowed. And also it decreased our cost approximately 50%. And still we can control the sync payload without any issue. Another one is that I explained to you, we are reading from the Avro binary and turn to the row. This process is very painful and it's very costly and it's very slow. We use the binary and then we turn to the generic record. Using the Avro utils, we turn to that generic record to row and feed it the SQL transform, which is provided from Beam. Then we get the result, turn to the generic record for some cases, and turn to the output format and byte array. This takes a lot of time, and to make the near real-time pipelines, we implement a new library, which is reading from our binary, and turn to the row directly. And the same case from row to byte array, whatever the desired output format. It could be JSON or Avro, but we turn to the directly. With this improvement, we increase our serialization and deserialization performance 10x. It was awesome. And we decrease the overall data flow cost approximately 60%. And today we know that we can process 3,000 logs, 3,000 events per second per vCPU. Okay, this is my last slide. I know we passed 3 minutes. Sorry for that. The last improvement, performance improvement actually. It is a cost improvement. The data flow is provide awesome feature, auto-scaling. It scale up and down, and it deal with the idle resources. If we don't need it, we don't need to over-provision that. and it always used whatever the traffic we need to process. But it has one bug. I can say bug, but it is not the bug actually. It doesn't decrease the worker from less than the one. But some cases, you know, the sometimes streaming jumps for a while, like small window of 1 or 2 hours, they don't receive any logs, and we should not run those jobs for a while. Then we implement the cold starter. The same idea, our Kafka checker is persisted all of the Kafka information data store side, and cold starter decide that which job needs to be hibernated or which job needs to be resumed based on the data traffic. And it just take 5 minutes, around 5 minutes to get back a job. This is my last presentation.